Hey, this is Mike from Royal Blood, and you're listening to Laura Whitmore on BBC Five Live.
More from Laura and Alex shortly, but after 10:30, we're going under the spotlight with Mike Kerr from British rock duo Royal Blood. I ask all my guests about the lyric that they live for, basically a line in a song that means a lot to them. And this is Mike's.
Lyrics were something I never tuned into until I was a bit older. And this is like the first moment I remember a lyric hitting me. And it's in Go With The Flow by Queens of the Stone Age, where the lyric is, I want something good to die for, to make it beautiful to live. And that's the first time I was like, I stopped air drumming for a moment and really tuned in. And I think that really set me on a course to think about, yeah, how important lyrics are and how it can change the way you feel about a song.
I'm Laura Whitmore, and my guest on this edition of Under the Spotlight will be well known to any of you fond of a bit of rock and roll. He's one half of Brighton rock duo Royal Blood, and along with drummer Ben Thatcher, is a Brit Award winner and one of the best live bands on the British music scene. Their first two albums were global hits and went straight to number one in the UK. In 2021, they're back with their third album, Typhoons. It's time for singer and bassist Mike Kerr from Royal Blood to go under the spotlight. Chatting now to Mike from Royal Blood. Welcome to Under the Spotlight. How are you?
I'm doing good, thanks. How are you?
Yeah, not too bad. First of all, congratulations. The new album is out now, Typhoons, the third album. Quite exciting to be bringing out new music after a pandemic.
Yeah. You know what? It was strangely exciting making a record in the middle of a pandemic, because part of me knew this was going to end at some point. So writing songs knowing that, yeah, there's going to be this big party and this big celebration of this thing ending, it was weirdly quite inspiring.
So how did you do it? Was it different to how you recorded the previous albums? Were you in a studio? Was it home studio? How did it happen?
So it began in a proper studio up in London. We were about halfway through recording the album we had at the time, and we had to drop tools, walk out the studio, go home. So it was really disappointing. And there'd been so much leading up to that point. But looking back, it was the best thing that could have happened to us, because I went back home, spent about a week at home, got really bored and started writing extra songs, kind of thinking these won't really go on the record. Just it sort of entertaining myself, if anything. And through that process, because it was so nonchalant and pressure free, I ended up writing four or five extra songs, which are the best songs on the record. If that hadn't have happened, we wouldn't have really had these songs. So we ended up recording those songs at our home studio, literally up the road. And because no one else could be around, we had to do everything ourselves. So we would never have made the record like that or written the songs that way. So it's totally shaped by what's been going on.
Did it make you reflect on some of the songs you'd already recorded and look back on them and think, oh, maybe they're not what I thought they should be?
Definitely. Definitely. There was about four or five weaklings that we just
bye-bye
threw off the shelf. Yes, yeah, straight in the bargain bin. So we almost like upgraded our record.
Yeah, you mentioned there just about kind of when you do the home studio stuff at the studio up the road, where you end up doing more work. And I feel like every artist I've talked to recently who've brought out a new album around this time, with Kylie Minogue on, and she was saying like she's learned all these new technical skills that like she almost deserves another credit on the album. Did you feel that, I know, besides being, you know, bassist and writer, lead singer, that like you kind of have like techie involved there as well, a little bit of producing?
Yeah. It's something I've so desperately not wanted to learn, but over the years I've just accumulated this knowledge of how to record myself properly and how to, yeah, essentially self-produce. So it's a self-produced album because we had such a vision for what we wanted to do and we knew exactly how we wanted to do it. It was actually quite nice not having a producer. It just meant we could go absolutely nuts, you know, with no one stopping us.
The dream. Even though the label may freak out, but it's the dream for any musician.
That's it, yeah.
Fans will know you from the previous two albums, you know, which are number one albums. But they, you know, they know your sound and kind of this grungy rock band, and still very much there in the music. But you know, you've also got a little bit of dance in there, some disco inspiration. What made you want to kind of play around with that?
Well, we realised that at the end of every show, we would go on the tour bus and would have this all-night party until we got to the next town. And the music we were playing was ABBA, the Bee Gees, Michael Jackson, James Brown, Janet. We were just this big party, and it was so much fun. I think we just wanted to bring a bit of that fun into our music. Everything had got, without, you know, no pun intended, everything got very dark and very rock and very serious. And once we started writing songs like this, it was just very hard to stop. They were so fun to play, and it just felt like a breath of fresh air from what we usually did.
I think a lot of people, I know from my own experience from interviewing lots of artists, and particularly the rock bands, and you kind of have an idea from what you see on stage of who those people are. And then you meet them backstage, and I've interviewed so many different people, and I'm like, the rock stars are kind of the most fun. It's always like the pop stars who are a little bit darker behind the scenes.
Oh, yeah.
And then it's kind of nice to kind of show their personality, because I'm assuming a lot of people, when they meet you guys, you and Ben, that they kind of think, oh, they're going to be very, take themselves very seriously, and, you know, they're into their hard rock, but you guys like to have fun.
There's definitely, like, our lighter and fun side is definitely heard, particularly in the music on this record. But yeah, you're right. Particularly at the beginning, where we were playing like very like serious, like blues rock at the beginning, and then people would say things like, "Oh, you're actually all right." Like they assumed I would be unbearable to be around. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, oh, you're happy and you can smile as well. It's great.
Yeah, that's it.
I mean, I've seen you guys perform live. You are a live band, you know, when you take to that stage, and you're used to constantly touring, whether it's your own gigs. I know you've got a big arena tour next year and you've supported massive bands. How has it been not having that outlet of performing this year?
Really, really weird. Yeah, it just sucks, really, because, you know, I think that's the thing we really pride ourselves on, is being able to play live and connecting with our fans in that way. Particularly when we have new music as well, we always, the first time we play our fans hear a new bit of music, it's usually live on stage. So to not have that, yeah, it's been really weird. But it is what it is, and the live show are coming back. And this, I guess the silver lining around it all for us has been, I don't know, I felt very present as this album's slowly being released and how these songs are coming out. I feel like I'm sort of witnessing my own rocket launch.
Do you think you've changed as an artist with this album? Do you think your performance will be different when you're back on stage touring?
No, I think it's about, I think we have the same energy as when we started, really. It is a young man's game, you know. it is still a crazy way to live your life, you know. Like everyone, though, we'll have a much deeper appreciation for the experience of playing a show and being together in that way.
Yeah, you own those early morning kind of call times or traveling and the constant traveling. I think a lot of people, some, you know, in the industry, when it's constant, it can be a lot. You can take it for granted.
Yeah.
I think now you're like, yeah, I don't mind what time we're starting.
Exactly.
Get me on the road.
Exactly.
I'm Laura Whitmore here on BBC Five Live. And my Under the Spotlight is Mike from Royal Blood. I just kind of want to take you back, because people see you on stage and they see you and Ben, rock stars. But you know, you grew up in Worthing and you kind of forget you're just like two guys who grew up who loved music. Did you grow up with rock music? Did you grow up knowing you wanted to be a musician? Was it more a hobby on the side, a passion? How did you get into it?
It really started from my upbringing, which was essentially like going to church every Sunday with my parents, you know. I was a good Christian boy once upon a time. And It's a strange world, because I was able to play music once a week, you know, in front of a live audience from a very early age, even though the music was lame. Let's be real about that. But in that environment, I met members of my first band, and we sort of left church and were like, right, let's start a rock band. And yeah, I guess our upbringing really came from that. It came from leaving that behind us and going out into the world and discovering what was out there for us. And the only way we knew how to go and discover things was by playing music. Ben ended up in one of my first bands playing guitar. I was playing keytar.
Best instrument ever is the keytar, by the way.
It is. Well, they say the hardest part about playing keytar is not having any friends, so... But yeah, it was a moment. I was playing. I remember one night I actually sprayed myself gold with car paint as well. Not a good idea.
Oh, don't try that at home.
I think it's pretty dangerous. I think that's how, isn't it? That's in the Bond film, isn't it?
It is in the Bond film, yeah. Is that what you're trying to do? Recreate the Bond
Goldfinger, yeah. That's how they die. Yeah. You like suffocate. Awful. Yeah. Don't do that at home.
Okay, so you cover yourself in gold to try and make the keytar cooler.
It was an attempt, yeah.
Did it feel kind of risky at the time? Because, you know, you were going to church every Sunday and then you kind of left that and then, you made a rock band. Mm. Like, how did people around you kind of react to that?
Oh, terribly. Yeah, leaving that behind you is a big deal, you know. You're sort of cut out from a world. And when you're 16, 17, you know, that's quite a big change in your life, you know. But, you know, it's the first move of like proper independence, you know, and making decisions for yourself. I think from that point onwards, yeah, we just had so much fun with music. That's another thing as well, in that upbringing, music was very serious. It was never a laughing matter. Where suddenly it felt like, because we'd been oppressed so much in that way, when we went out to writing our own songs, we were like, oh, we can write songs about whatever we want, you know? So we were just going, out came the keytar and the gold paint and we were running around, you know, going mad.
What were you listening to yourself? Like, who were your influences around then when you were 16?
I just started listening to bands like Nirvana, Queens of the Stone Age, the Foo Fighters.
Actually, you worked with Josh, didn't you? He produced...
That's right. Yeah. So Josh produced Boilermaker, which is on the record.
Wow.
Which is insane to me, you know, to think, you know, when I was growing up, you know, we just studied his records. And yeah, so going on tour with him was like a masterclass, and then getting to work together was a dream come true.
So you were in all these bands when you were at 16, these rock bands. Ben was in one of them, and then moved to Australia for a bit.
So yeah, I guess flash forward a couple of years, I'd started playing bass and singing and I'd formed a band, but I was so bored of the sleepy seaside life of Worthing. I decided to go to Australia with nothing to lose. And I went there and, you know, it was fun. I felt like I was beginning to cut my teeth, you know. I'd never really sung in front of anyone before and I was just taking risks and I guess sort of working out who I was really and who I wanted to be. It didn't last very long out there because I just missed playing music with Ben, you know. He wasn't over there. So as soon as I came back, I had a bunch of songs and I said, look, I'd love you to be in the band. Let's go record some demos and see what happens. And that essentially is the beginning of our journey.
It's the beginning of Royal Blood. And was it always did you always know that this was your career? Because a lot of musicians sometimes start, they do it as an outlet on the side. Like, at what point did you know, like, this is more than just, I know I'm good at singing or I'm good at putting music together. At what point did you go, this is a career, this is it?
I was so driven to do this full time or as much as possible. I guess when the first album was really kicking off, that's when I seriously considered this could be a full-time gig for at least 5 years.
Yeah.
I never see it. I always see it as a rug you're standing on that can get pulled at any minute, which is why you've got to remain good.
Each album is important.
I always see it in like five-year chunks. So I think when that album was kicking off, I was like, I think we just bought 5 years of time to be able to do this, you know.
You've had some pretty like iconic moments. 2015, I think, was when you won the Brit Award. Jimmy Page gave you the Brit Award for Best British Group, which is a huge award. And you won the Icon Award with the Crying Awards. Like, do you have those moments like that when, you know, it's all about the music, but to get that kind of recognition by huge people like that, by the fans, must be incredible.
Yeah, it's wild. Particularly someone like Jimmy Page, where I remember my time in Australia, again, just immersing myself in the Led Zeppelin catalogue.
Mm-hmm.
I was bathing in it, and it was so influential to how I play and how I write and how I think about music. For it to be like a full circle moment and receive an award from him was just insane, you know. And it's not about the validation necessarily. It was more because, yeah, validation from other people, it can get a bit toxic, you know, if you go around looking for that. It was more that it was specifically him, you know. He's the guy that kind of had already given me the gift of his music, you know.
I want to talk about the tour I mentioned next year, and I think we're all dying to get back to gigs. It's an arena tour. I think you've got your biggest London show to date.
Yeah.
Do you like the crowds? Do the crowds help you? And also, do you have, we talked to, was it Dan from Bastille recently, and he always gets really nervous backstage. He says he feels like there's like two people. There's the person on stage and there's the person who comes off stage. And they're very two different people. Do you have that, or is it still Mike?
Yeah, you know, that's an interesting topic because it's something I've thought about recently quite a lot. Mm-hmm. At the beginning, it wasn't me, mm-hmm. because the idea of me going out there was like terrifying, you know. It was much easier to walk out and be someone fictional. Mm-hmm. But I think as time's gone on, I've recognised that it is me. It's just a part of me that makes complete sense on stage. Mm-hmm. And it's almost like, you know, a heavyweight boxing champion is in a totally different mindset when you walk into the ring. Mm-hmm. However, that mindset and that attitude would be totally inappropriate going for coffee with your mother-in-law, you know?
Yeah. It might be a little bit much.
Exactly, yeah. And I've come to a place where I'm like, no, I can be myself. It's just, yeah, it's a part of me that belongs on stage.
Before you go up on stage, because there's so much energy when you guys go up, do you have any way to warm up? Is there any, like, what do you do to kind of get yourselves into that zone?
It's changed over the years. It used to be about a bottle of tequila and some dressing room trashing and some wrestling. I've had to switch that to copious amounts of sparkling water and boxing as well, which I do now.
Oh, wow.
Because I don't drink anymore. I'm now sober. So I've had to just completely shift tactics.
Do you miss that? Because I know a lot of people sometimes use alcohol as a crutch, or sometimes, you know, when you're on stage, you're so buzzing and then you come off stage that it's very hard to go from that to like zero again, back to like Micah goes for coffee with the mother-in-law. Do you know that kind of vibe? How do you kind of switch off then? And especially since, you know, you gave up alcohol.
Coming off and winding down is extremely difficult. Yeah. For me, my sort of approach hasn't changed. It's like I come off stage and instead of calming down, I actually burn myself out. What I would do is I'd have a boxing bag in my dressing room, and as soon as the show was over, I'd get my wraps on, get my gloves on, and go straight into 45 minutes of that.
Yeah.
Because you're left with all this energy and there's nothing to do with it. Whereas before, I would go straight for the tequila and straight looking for a party, you know. So I obviously can't do that anymore. So I had to find something else. So the boxing. And it just like burns you out until you surrender, and you're like, it's almost like tapping out of the party at that point. By the time I'm back on the bus, I'm like unconscious in a good way.
Listening to ABBA in the background.
Listening to ABBA, like turn it down.
But there is that, if you want longevity, and you know, you had such a successful first album, there was a lot of hype around you, you get invited to lots of parties and it can be quite full on. Did you kind of have to have that conversation between the two of you going, look, if we want longevity, like we're going to have to work on this, we can't do too much in one go, we want to do this forever?
Yeah, it was more of a personal decision for me, because I was always the last man standing and so much comes on my head, you know. I have I just felt myself burning out. I knew that this was gonna end quickly if I didn't do something about it. I certainly wouldn't have been able to write a third album that was any good. So it was almost like I had to do that in order to keep the band alive.
You and Ben have been friends for years, and you know, there's just two of you. I know there's other people involved when you go on tour, but it's just the two of you out there, which is a little bit different than other rock bands where there's a lot more people. How has it been during, because I know you guys live near each other?
We actually live as far away from each other as you can in Brighton, but that's
but still in Brighton.
Yeah, it's I'm sure that's accidental.
I guess because you spend so much time with this person, and you know, you work together, you're mates. Have you been able to, besides doing the record stuff, have you seen each other as much as you'd like to during this time? Have you had a little break? Has it been good for the band? Are you ready to get back out there again together?
You know what? It's been okay. We've managed to spend a pretty decent amount of time working on the record. Having our own studio has been a bit of a blessing. I guess there was a period where we were probably 2 months apart, which is quite a long time for us.
Yeah.
But maybe it's knowing that we're in the same city, it doesn't feel like such a distance, you know.
And sometimes it's nice to have a little break.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. I'm sure he's glad to have a break from me, to be honest with you.
Mike, it's an absolute pleasure talking to you. Congratulations on the new album, Typhoons, which is out now. And looking forward to seeing you guys live again soon.
Nice one. Great to chat.